Good morning, participants. Before I start, you know, I will try to answer some of the questions that we have been receiving at the chat mode. I would just like to mention that, you know, the number of questions that we are getting, unfortunately, are too large, and it's not possible for me to answer all of them, though I would have liked to do it. So what I am doing, I pick up essentially some questions which are sort of important questions, and especially there are one or two points which are, I think, are good questions and they require a little bit more discussion. So I'll explain them a little bit more in detail before we go ahead. So let me start with first question. It says that as we know, the double slit interference is the superposition of two single slit diffraction phenomenon. Can we get double slit interference curve by some mathematical operations of two single slit diffraction curves? Well, the answer is yes and no. See, thing is that first of all, it's not really superposition of two single slit diffraction phenomenon. Had it been, then we would not have this particular issue. We could have always written N12 is equal to N1 plus N2. But there is always a mathematical way in which we can, you know, sort of discuss or describe the interference of two waves. Same way it can actually lead to the interference pattern. So there is a standard mathematics available for the Young's double slit experiment, which is generally taught at the high school level. And that's the similar type of mathematics will apply also when we are talking of diffraction of electrons. So as I say, as far as we are concerned, probably there is no difference between electrons and photons because both are particles, except that electron is massive and therefore depending upon the energy, its wavelength would be different. For the same energy, the energy of the photon and electron will be different, otherwise we can use mathematically exactly the same technique. Now, second question is that can we measure the phase speed, that's the velocity of wave packet, by experiment? See, again, I repeat that velocity of wave packet is not a phase speed, but it's a group speed. And phase speed is purely of mathematical consequence. It has no realistic bearing. So we cannot talk of phase speed or any measurement of phase speed. Whatever we measure is always the group speed. Now, the next question is that different color corresponds to different wavelengths, which according to de Broglie principle corresponds to different momentum of photon. Now, when we are talking of photon, you know, normally we do not apply de Broglie principle to calculate the wavelength because that's given more from relativity. For the case of photon, we have discussed that momentum of the photon is given by h nu by c. This particular thing I will describe more in detail when we are discussing the relativity portion. Basically, relativity says that if a particle has a zero rest mass and its energy is E, then its momentum must be E by c. So, this is from that particular equation that we get the standard equation, which if you already know, it's all right, but if you do not know, we will be discussing it when we are discussing relativity. Is this equation? This is the relationship between energy and momentum, okay? And when we say energy, energy is the total relativistic energy, which does not have a classical analog. So when we put m naught equal to 0, we get E is equal to pc. So therefore, the momentum is equal to h nu by c. So this can be written by h by lambda. So this is strictly speaking not de Broglie relationship that we are applying to evaluate the wavelength of the photon, which can actually directly be obtained from frequency. That's not an issue, okay? The only thing which we say that this expression p is equal to h upon lambda was taken by de Broglie also for massive particles. So when we talk of de Broglie relationship, we generally talk it for massive particle, not necessarily for photons. Now, the question is that different color corresponds to different wavelength, I mean, that's as we have mentioned, that's different frequencies, which according to de Broglie principle corresponds to different moment of the photon. That's perfectly right, because the moment of the photon would actually depend on the frequency, and the color of a light also depends on the frequency. So there is no contradiction about that. Now, next question is about different type of photons, which I do not understand the question. I do not mean a photon is a photon. Of course, photon can have a different energy. Photon can correspond to a different wavelength or different frequency. But you know, a photon is a photon. So I do not really know what you mean by different type of photons. Now, the next question is that do the wave packet is considered for one particle, is then how come multiple characteristic can exist for single particle with k, k plus dk, k minus dk? That's what I was always trying to tell, that when we associate a wave packet with a particular particle, the wave packet actually consists of a large number of values of k, which essentially means a large value of lambdas. So therefore, we cannot associate a fixed value of k corresponding to a particular wave packet, and that's how the actual uncertainty principle gives rise to. Okay, so I'm not sure whether I have understood the question, but this is what I could make it out. The next question is that can you give the physical significance of complex nature of wave function? Okay, as I have been mentioning again and again, that This is complex, but whatever is the observable is the real thing, and we have only discussed so far how to obtain the probability of finding the particle, but how the wave function is to be used for obtaining certain other information we'll be discussing in subsequent lectures. Now, next question is that how size of wave packet changes with momentum of particle giving Heisenberg principle. This is what I have sort of briefly mentioned, though not really mathematically. Probably I'll ask our TAs to work out one or two simple problems on these things. Basically, I have told in a sort of a very, very qualitative or hand waving way that, you know, when you have a larger range of sort of wave vectors combining, you essentially get a shorter wave packet. So, that is what I would like to say. If it is a wave, what is the difference between A sin kx minus omega t and A sin kx plus omega t? This I think also I have mentioned earlier that if you are taking A sin kx minus omega t and A sin kx plus omega t, both represent sinusoidal wave, except that this particular wave travels in plus x direction while this wave travels in minus x direction. So, that is the only difference, because as I said, it depends on the relative sign of x term and t term. So, this is t term, there is a negative sign here, this is x term, there is a positive sign here. So, if the signs are opposite, this will represent a wave which is traveling in plus x direction, because if t goes up, x also has to go up to keep kx minus omega t constant, which essentially means keeping phase as a constant. On the other hand, if I put A sin kx plus omega t, if t goes up, then x has to go down in order to keep the same phase. It means if you are looking at a point at the which has the same phase, okay, as t progresses, that will have to move in minus x direction. So, this will represent a wave which is traveling in minus x direction, while this represents a wave which travels in a plus x direction. Now, we go to the next question. In a double slit experiment with electron, will there be any effect of repulsive force on the interference pattern? This also had discussed earlier, saying that, you know, this particular interference pattern would be valid even if we take, if we put the electrons just one by one. Probably in Moodle, I will give you some websites from where you can download some of the videos of the recent experiments which have been done, where you can really see that this interference pattern will be valid even if you are taking electrons just one by one. So, effectively the, that would have been the first doubt, that, you know, whether electrostatic interaction between these particles would have changed things, but no, that does not happen. Also, I would like to add that, you know, even if we do not have electrons, we have neutrons which are not charged particles, still I can perform the same interference experiments and I will have no worries and I will exactly get similar type of results. Then next question is that in a single slit electron diffraction, what happens to the electrons after hitting the screen? You know, we do not bother what happens when it has hits the screen. This could probably just get absorbed, and if I have a detector, probably this will create some pulses which can be used for counting the total number of electrons. So, that is of no consequence of what happens this electron when it hits the screen. I mean, normally there will be a detector if I want to check it, okay. So, this particular electron will detect, will create some sort of pulses in that detector which can eventually be used by a counter to count them, okay. And if there is no detector, probably it will get absorbed. I mean, electrons are fairly reactive particle, they can very easily get absorbed in a sort of system. Next is, in the electron double slit experiment, the electrons interfere like waves, yet they interact with the screen like particles. So, we can see both in wave and particle nature are manifest in this experiment. No, that I am not very sure whether this is a correct statement the way you have written. First of all, I am not sure when, how you are saying that when it hits the screen, it acts like particle. Okay, it only acts as like, it, you know, you could also think of a wave packets which are hitting there. Moreover, when we are talking of complementarity, you know, we are talking of at a single time. So, when we are talking, you know, when you are doing an experiment at a given time, whether I can look both at the wave property and the particle property. So, I am not fully convinced with this type of question. Now, the next question is that in time, independent Schrodinger's wave equation, how partial derivatives change to perfect derivative? So, let me just sort of explain this particular thing. For example, if we have term like this, del, I am just giving an example of, let us say, f t into phi of x. If I take partial derivative, by definition of partial derivative, it will mean that when I am taking derivative with respect to x, time has to be treated as constant. So, therefore, this f t, which is only a function of time and does not contain any x, the entire factor has to be treated as a constant. So this I can write almost as C multiplied by phi x, where C is a constant. So this Ft will just come out of this particular thing. So I can write this as Ft of del x of phi of x. Now, there is a need to write partial derivatives only in the case when you have multiple variables here, okay, and then you want to insist that I am taking derivative with respect to this variable, keeping other variables constant. Now, because Ft, which was the other variable, has already come out of the differential sign. So, and the thing which is in front of this differential sign is only a function of x. So, it makes no sense to write the partial derivative, because the function on which this particular derivative is operating is purely a function of x, and I am also taking derivative with respect to x. So, therefore, I can always write this as Ft of d phi dx. That is what it was the idea. Of course, you take the second derivative, the same thing will apply in this particular case also, or when we take derivative with respect to time also, it will apply exactly the same thing. Now, next question is that in uncertainty, if the wave packet is large or small, then what about the position momentum of the particle? This also I thought I had described about the uncertainty principle, that if the wave packet is large, then we say uncertainty in the position is large. If wave packet is small, then we say the uncertainty in the position is small, okay. But in order to generate a smaller wave packet, I have to have a larger values or larger range of k values, okay, mixed up. So therefore, a smaller length of the wave packet implies a larger range of k, larger dispersion, I mean larger variation in the values of k, which means a larger variation in the value of momentum. So that is what I meant. I am not sure whether I have understood the question very clearly. Now, next question is that is a sin kx plus omega t is a wave? I have just now explained, yes, it is a wave, but it is a wave which is moving in minus x direction. Is delta x delta p equal to h or h cross or h cross by 2? This also I think I had explained last time, that you know, and today in fact probably I will work it out, taking an actual wave function, how delta x and delta p turn out to be. Because see, so long whatever we have talked about the uncertainty principle was fairly vague, okay, fairly qualitative, okay, we have not really quantified anything, we are just talking again in a hand waving fashion, okay. But now we are in a position to actually clearly, you know, sort of give an expression for uncertainty and derive the uncertainty principle. So, which I will be doing today. I mean, in a given problem, in fact, normally first year students always ask the question that, you know, what uncertainty principle should I use when you have been given a particular problem. Unfortunately, many of the problem for uncertainty principles are also fairly qualitative, and I also always answer that it does not matter which one you take, because all I am talking is an order of magnitude. And just for the ease of correction, whenever we set the question paper, we always give them that use this uncertainty principle, so that it becomes a little easier for us to evaluate the answer scripts. Otherwise, everyone uses a different uncertainty principle, and then, you know, for a big class, it is very difficult to evaluate the copies. Now, the next question is that is it possible to see electromagnetic waves, light waves? You know, this is again a very, I mean, I am not very sure what the question means. I mean, according to me, you never see a light or you never see a wave, a light wave, okay, you only feel it, okay, or you see the, you see objects in the light, okay, but you do not actually see the light. But I am not very sure what you mean by this particular question. Next question is it possible to arrive at Schrodinger wave equation with form other than the third equation in representation of wave? I said you cannot obtain using sine and cosine, because if you use sine and cosine, that will never solve that particular equation, because I am taking a relationship between the second derivative of x with the first derivative in time, and sine and cosine functions will not be a solution. But instead of plus I k x minus omega t, I could have taken minus I k x minus omega t, which I have also mentioned. The Schrodinger equation will change, but then when I am interpreting the things, I have to always keep this thing in mind that time factor will be plus I omega t there. And how does this time factor will you know, sort of be useful, you know, we will see when we are, you know, solving some of the problems here. Then we go justification of a photon or a light source to see photons in a thought experiment, not so clear. Sorry, the question is also not very clear. Justification of photon or light source to see electrons. See, all I am trying to say, let me just try to re-explain this thing, maybe that will help. See, strictly speaking, I do not see the electrons, but as I said, these are sort of a thought experiment. I mean, these experiments cannot be performed at this particular level, but you know, on the other hand, you know, we just describe them in a more dramatic fashion, so as to, you know, convey the idea that we want to actually convey. So, I mean, let us agree that we are not really watching the electrons, or we do not have a method by which we will really watch the electrons. The basic thing that I am trying to say is that if at all we are able to perform an experiment where I put a light source here, let us say somewhere here, and an electron is passing, or something like that, that if I have to find out if there are two doors in a room and I have to find out whether a person has gone from this door or from this particular door, there has to be light source. If it is completely dark, I can never find from which particular door a person has entered the room. Now, if there is a light, then what will happen? As the person starts entering this particular room, there will be light reflection from that particular person, and then we will see, oh, this particular person has actually entered the room from this particular door. If I see a reflection coming from here of somebody's face from this particular door, close to this particular door, then we know, oh, this particular person has entered the room from this particular door. So, I am just sort of extrapolating this particular thing to look at the electrons. So, I am imagining that if an electron goes from this particular slit, okay, and if I have a light source, then okay, this particular light reflected from electron will tell me whether this electron is really going from this particular slit. Okay. Similarly, if there is a reflection of light coming from this particular close to this particular slit, I say, oh, this electron is actually going from this particular slit. So, what I was trying to say, that every electron which reaches a screen, okay, in principle, you can find out from which particular slit that has come by actually watching them. See, as I said, that if it is completely dark everywhere and there are students entering the classroom, okay, I will never be able to tell from which door they have entered. But on the other hand, if there is a light source, then by looking at their face and finding out from which particular door they are coming, I can always find out which person has come from which particular door. So, in that sense, in a more dramatic sense, I have used this particular idea that I am trying to watch the electrons, but I am strictly speaking not watching the electron. I cannot watch the electron, but this is just to sort of explain a little bit of idea. The only thing is that when a student enters the room, the effect of photon is very, very small. Okay, but in the case of electron being a very lighter particle, when photon interacts with electron, it will always cause a scattering of the electron because their momentum are of similar order. In fact, when we do Compton effect, we will discuss that this is precisely the Compton effect experiment, that when a photon actually interacts with an electron, it can change the path of electron. Okay, photon interacting with a student probably will not change the path of the person. But on the other hand, you know, a photon interacting with electron may change its path. So, what we are saying is that this photon which are coming and interacting with these electrons, if at all I want to watch the experiment, then these photons have to interact with these electrons, and these electrons probably would have changed the way they were actually going had there been no photon. And therefore, that could be thought as one of the reason why the interference pattern has got destroyed. So, basically what we are trying to say is that if I can perform an experiment by which I am reasonably sure that electron is going from slit 1 or slit 2, we will always find that any electron reaching on this side is definitely has come from slit 1 or from slit 2. But in that case, I will never be able to see interference pattern. So long I keep this vagueness, I do not ask the question, okay, I keep perfect dark here, so to say, dark under quotes, so that these electrons do whatever they want and I am not asking them question how they are coming, okay, that only in that particular condition I will be able to see the interference pattern. So, that is what actually is basically uncertainty principle. Okay, I have to accept this uncertainty that I will not be able to find out from which particular slit the electron goes if I have to really see the interference pattern. The next question is about the group velocity and phase velocity. This I thought I will explain a little bit more in detail because, you know, there are quite a few questions on this particular thing. I have purposely avoided the use of term phase velocity for the matter waves, though many textbooks talk about it, and I will tell you the reason why I sort of avoided it, but because there have been questions, so let me try to sort of answer it now. See, thing is that, as we know that the phase velocity is defined as omega by k and group velocity is defined as d omega dk. We also mentioned that the two velocities would be same if we have a simple relationship of the type omega is equal to vk. Alright, now let us try to find out the phase velocity. Of course, this particular relationship is nothing but nu times lambda, because omega is 2 pi nu and k is 2 pi by lambda. So, this is just nu by lambda. So, let us try to find out for the particle waves. So, for particle waves, if I write the phase velocity, lambda will be equal to h by p. This is, you know, standard de Broglie relationship. The problem is that how do we define the frequency of a matter wave? In fact, this is precisely the reason that I did not want to raise this particular issue, because this is a little more complex issue. See, generally in the experiments we always measure the lambda, so we do not have a really a unique method of, as far as I know, cannot talk about the frequency, but in order to maintain consistency with whatever we have been talking in physics, okay, we can define frequency or omega by the relationship E is equal to h nu, where h is the Planck's constant. Okay. Now, when we are talking of E, again I have not done relativity, so that was another reason I did not want to talk about it, but just I will give you the result that E, in principle I have just now written the expression that E is equal to E square P square C square plus M naught square C to the power 4. Now, we can also define kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is different from E, and we talk of E is equal to K plus M naught C square, which is the rest mass energy, assuming that there is no other type of sort of energies are involved. Okay. Now, because for photon, rest mass energy turns out to be 0, so E turns out to be equal to K. So, in that case, whether I write K is equal to h nu or whether I write E is equal to h nu, it makes no difference. But in the case of massive particle, there is a slight ambiguity that I can either write K is equal to h nu or E is equal to h nu. Both will be consistent with the definition of the photon, with the expression that we use, will be consistent with the expression that we use for the case of photons. So, as far as this particular aspect is concerned, there is slight ambiguity of how do we define the frequency, but let us use any one of them. If I use E is equal to h nu, then what you can write this nu, this as far as nu, we will write E upon h. If I write E upon h, this h will cancel, then we will get E upon p. And if I am talking of total energy, that in relativity is given by mc square. And P given is given by M times V. These expression we will derive later, not really derive, but you know, we will come across later when we do relativity at the end of this particular workshop. Okay. But if I do that, this M will cancel. Remember, this M is not M naught, but M which depends on velocity. So, this expression turns out to be equal to C square by V or C square by U, let us say, where U is the speed of the particle. So, what we see, because generally U has to be always smaller than C, in fact, by relativity U has to be always smaller than C. So, the phase velocity turns out to be larger than the speed of light. So, always people ask the question that, you know, how a de Broglie wave can travel with speed larger than velocity. But remember, this is only the phase speed, and phase speed has of no physical consequence. If we take the group speed or group velocity, that will always turn out to be equal to the particle velocity and not C square by U. Okay. In fact, I have asked our TAs to work out this particular problem. They will probably work it out today, not today, but tomorrow, when they will really show that, you know, if you try to calculate the group speed, it will always turn out to be equal to the speed of the particle, and that is what is of more importance, because phase speed, as I have said, is purely of mathematical consequence. Okay, no particle moves with the phase speed. Okay, of course, there is also an ambiguity. In fact, as I said, that instead of E, I could have used K. Okay, if I use K, then I can write H is equal to P. And I can write this as k by h, and assuming that the particle is non-relativistic, which we do in the case of Schrodinger equation, I can write this as h, and p I can write as m v, and k I can write as half m v square by h. Then h would cancel, then m will cancel, this v will go, and this turns out to be equal to v by 2. So, if I use this particular expression of k is equal to h nu instead of E is equal to h nu, I get the phase speed to be equal to v by 2. Now, this is also not right in the sense that the phase speed of the de Broglie wave turns out to be half the speed of the particle, or let us say u by 2. I have used u here, so I can use u here also, u square, so it is u by 2. Alright, but as I said, no, these are only for mathematical delight. Physics wise, it does not make a difference, because physics wise is only the group velocity which turns out to be of importance. And we can show that whether we take E is equal to h nu or whether we take k is equal to h nu, the group speed will always turn out to be equal to u. And this is what is of importance, that de Broglie wave will travel with the same speed as the speed of the particle. And this is what we must expect, that the wave, the speed of the wave which is associated with the particle must travel with the same speed as the particle, otherwise it makes no sense that waves moves at a different speed, wave packet goes with a different speed than the particle. Okay, so this is what we expect, and that you can show that this will be true whether you take k is equal to h nu or whether we take e is equal to h nu. Unfortunately, it so happens that when we actually sort of come to Schrodinger equation, we always use k is equal to h nu. So there, as I say, there is a small amount of ambiguity, small amount of doubt, because if you could perform an experiment and could really measure what is the frequency of the particle, we would not have this particular doubt. But it so happens that whether we use k is equal to h nu or whether we take e is equal to h nu, it does not make a difference. So this ambiguity always remains. Now, next question is that what is the difference between classical theory and quantum theory? Means limitation of classical theory and how quantum theory is emerged out, please explain in brief. This particular thing I think we will discuss little later as we are going ahead in the course. Regarding wave and particle duality, does it mean that only multiple electrons show a property and not a single electron? See, as I said, that this particular wave is a probability wave. This also I have discussed, that if you are talking of one particular electron, okay, this of course is governed by the wave nature, but on the other hand, this will always arrive at some place, okay. Only when we perform this experiment multiple times, in fact, I have given that particular example of wave function, which I will be discussing today also, okay, what we actually mean by the probability. It's almost like a head and tail, that, you know, if I just toss a coin, even though the probability of getting a head is, let's say, half, but when you toss the coin, you know, you will get either head or tail. It's also like, it's possible that first time you get head, second time also you may get head, third time also you may get head. It does not mean that the probability becomes 1. Okay, you have to perform this experiment really over a large number of time to get probability to be equal to half. So, because the wave function is actually a probability wave, therefore, if you want to really detect the overall nature of the wave, you have to perform the experiment over a very, very large number of particles. But once you perform only in one of these things, okay, the particle will always appear somewhere. Okay. The next question is, uncertain dilation exists for two cases, one for single slit diffraction, other for the wave. Can you explain me if there is a generalized uncertain relation? See, uncertain relation is always a general relationship. What I have tried to do is to get an idea of uncertain relationship by two different methods. But as I have said, there are much better mathematical ways of looking into it, okay, which I am doing partly here. I will be doing partly today. And, you know, some of these things will form actually a little later part of the advanced quantum mechanics course, which is beyond the scope of this particular course. Next question is that, you know, we have been talking only of diffraction of electron and not of interference and polarization. This is a sort of interesting question. The thing is that, you know, diffraction is also, so to say, a sort of interference. So, of course, you know, depending upon what type of experiments we are trying to do is, we call it diffraction or interference. I mean, we can definitely perform the interference experiment. Double slit experiment is generally called as an interference experiment. Single slit is generally called a diffraction experiment. So, both these things are possible with electrons. As far as the polarization is concerned, this is interesting. Thing is that, you know, there is always a spin of the electron, and in principle, there is always a possibility of polarizing the current. In fact, these days in spintronics, we always get spin polarized currents. In neutron diffraction, there is also, when there are certain experimental techniques which talk about the polarized electron beam, in which, you know, you can really look at the spin, and this particular spin can be used, considered as a polarization, you know. See, like we can consider in which plane, in which particular direction E and B vectors oscillate, that gives you the idea of polarization. Similarly, we can talk of the spin as breaking that degeneracy and calling it a polarization. So, if you are talking of a spin polarized, a polarized beam of neutrons, it means basically their spins will be pointing out in a specific direction. The next question is that in single slit, why the electron diffracted is only if the slit width is very low. Actually, when slit width is very low, that is the time you will see a significant effect of diffraction. Otherwise, diffraction is always present. Because if you look at the equation, this is d sin theta is equal to lambda. So, therefore, only when d is, for a fixed lambda, only when d is smaller, the theta will be comparatively larger. If we are talking about wave group moving with same velocity equal to the velocity of the particle, now while we are forming the wave equation, we have reintroduced the phase velocity. See, strictly speaking, I have not introduced the phase velocity. I talked about the phase velocity when I was talking only in the case of wave equation. But, you know, as we are talking of electromagnetic waves in vacuum, they are non-dispersive, and therefore phase velocity and group velocity are same. So, as far as electromagnetic waves in vacuum are concerned, okay, I can talk about phase velocity because that happens to be equal to the group velocity. The uncertainty principle of position momentum is H that we derive using two approaches. How we get the value of minimum uncertainty product? Okay, that's what I say. I will refer you to advanced books on quantum mechanics, where they've said that the minimum product actually turns out to be for a Gaussian wave packet, which turns out to be equal to h cross by 2. Kindly elaborate again and significance of considering the solution of psi is equal to e raised to power I k x minus omega t. I said that this is the exponential type of the solution is the only possible solution which will solve that equation where we are relating the second derivative of position with respect to the first derivative of x. Again, the question is the wave packet is real, but why we take the wave function as a complex quantity? So when we talk of wave packet, we are not specifically talking about only the de Broglie wave, but we are talking of a wave in general, because whatever you have said about wave packet is a part of wave theory, which is valid even for electromagnetic waves or for that matter any other type of wave. So, wave packet when we are talking, we are not really talking about de Broglie, but it was a general thing. But it so happens that when we are talking about the wave associated with the particle, that turns out to be a complex quantity. So, that is the way I would like to say. We said about eigen and eigenvalue, that we will come to that in a little later. So, there is a question that what happens when the two waves of equal and opposite amplitude or whatever it is move in opposite direction, then we know that they form standing waves. Okay, you can always apply superposition principle in a proper way and get the result of what will happen to the disturbance. Then the other question is that why potential energy does not is not exclusively time dependent. I say if it is not exclusively time dependent, it could be time dependent, then I cannot use time independent Schrodinger equation, that is all I would say. Why time dependent term is negative in the wave equation, that is only a convention. Okay, I could have always worked out the entire quantum mechanics as with plus I omega t. Okay, the equation would have been different, nothing of physics would have changed. Okay, we are just using a convention so that you know we are consistent over all over the entire world, okay, entire textbook. So whenever we are talking of quantum mechanics, we generally always assume conventionally that the time dependent term is of the form of e raised to power minus I omega t. I think these are probably most of the questions which I have tried to answer. Now let's come to the actual lecture. Okay, so let's sort of recapitulate what we did last time. Using certain logic, we obtained the time dependent Schrodinger equation. This is the time dependent Schrodinger equation in 3 dimension. This whole operator can be written in terms of del square psi, and the advantage here is that this del square, depending upon the coordinate system that we use, can be expressed either in Cartesian coordinate system or spherical polar coordinates or cylindrical coordinates, whatever coordinates you want to use. Then we said for the case when we does not have an explicit time dependence, only in that case we succeeded in separating the variables to obtain time independent Schrodinger equation. So this is the time independent Schrodinger equation. Then we realize that the actual wave function psi x t will be whatever we obtain from the solution of this particular equation, that is phi x, then I have to multiply e raised to power minus I e t by h cross, which is actually the solution which has come from the time dependent part of the Schrodinger equation. So my wave function will always be given by this particular quantity. Then we started about the physical interpretation of the wave function in terms of probability of finding the particle. We explained these should not be there. We explained what we mean by the probability. We said that when we trying to calculate the probability of observing a particular particle, okay, we do not mean that this particular particle will keep on changing the position if we keep on measuring the position one after another, immediately one after another. Okay, once we have identified the particle and found it to be present somewhere, okay, immediately after that if we make the measurement, the particle will be only there. Okay, we cannot find it out that you know particle has gone somewhere else. So when we are talking of probability, we talk of probability measurement over a large number of particles. This is what I have been emphasizing, that we assume that we have very very large number of particles, okay, which are all given by exactly the same wave function. When you try to measure the position of the particle for all of them, you will not find an identical result. For some particle you will find its position somewhere, for another you will find somewhere else, okay, and that is why there is a probability associated with that. While unlike quantum mechanics, where if you know the conditions precisely, you would know the position precisely. In quantum mechanics, you get well defined probabilities, but you do not get well defined positions. Okay, now let us ask some of the interesting, some of the what we call as somewhat philosophical questions. And this is something on which there had been a lot of discussion earlier when the quantum mechanics was being developed. Now let us ask the question, suppose we have made a measurement and we find a particle somewhere. Okay, let us suppose we find a particle at x is equal to x naught, okay, or very close to x is equal to x naught when we made the measurement. Now question is that, was the particle there itself earlier or what happened? See, I have made a measurement at a given time, I find the position of particle to be there. But was the particle there before just now? Ok, okay, let's just try to ask this sort of a, I said, under quotes, a philosophical question. All right. Now, there were three different approaches which were given by earlier people. There are three types of interpretations or, you know, thoughts which were given to this position. So, question is that if a measurement was done and the particle was found at x is equal to x naught, where was it just before? The first view of looking into it is what we call as a condition of hidden variable. Okay. This people who took this particular realistic approach, they said that, okay, let me just try to read and then I will explain. Indeterminacy could be different from ignorance. The particle was there only, but we were not knowing. Some additional information was needed to provide the complete description. This is called the condition of hidden variables. Okay. Let me try to explain this particular aspect. See, when we toss a coin and get head and tail, we think that this is sort of random process. Okay, whenever there is a cricket match, you know, you just toss a coin, the umpire tosses a coin. Okay, then we will say head or tail, and then everyone assumes that this particular getting head or tail is a purely random function. But strictly speaking, is it really random? Okay, this particular coin which has been tossed, okay, it has been tossed under a force, you know, somebody has put a force, it goes up and comes down. Okay, if I know forces, air sort of pressures or whatever, air buoyancy, etc., everything, okay, this is purely a mechanical problem. Okay, in principle, I will be able to precisely, if I know all the conditions well, I can always predetermine whether this will be head or tail. The only thing, the variables that we are talking are too many variables and they are not really very easily controllable. So, when I am tossing a coin, okay, where I am hitting it, okay, what happens to this, what type of angular momentum I am providing, what type of, you know, momentum I am providing and things like that, and when I am catching the coin, how I am catching this particular thing, okay, there are so many variables involved with that, that I can sort of find it very, very difficult to control it. But suppose I had a control on these things, suppose I would have known my all those variables, then this is purely a mechanics problem. Okay, the coin goes up and coin comes down, it has to have either a head or tail, and I can predict whether it will be head or tail if I knew all the conditions of the problem. Unfortunately, I do not know them, and therefore I treat this particular phenomenon as random. So, a set of people thought that actually the particle was there when we took a measurement, just before the measurement also. Okay, only thing we were not knowing, because we did not know the parameter, how the particle came there at that particular point. Okay, I had no idea. Okay, I was not aware of this particular thing, I am not aware of all the variables. Only when I performed an experiment, then only I knew that my particle was there. Similar to tossing a coin, when I performed the experiment and I put the coin in my hand, then only I knew whether it will be head and tail. Okay, otherwise, when I am talking of head, it was actually the head there itself. Only thing I was not knowing, even just before I cast the coin, I knew, I mean, in principle the head was there, but I did not know. Okay. When I performed the experiment, then only I knew that the head was there. So, this is called the condition of hidden variable. Okay, so, some people thought that the way this particular wave mechanics works, the particle, when I have measured particle and found the particle to x is equal to x naught, at x is equal to x naught, the particle was actually there, but we were not knowing it. Okay, because we are not knowing, okay, all the conditions, all the variables which brought the particle there, just like tossing a coin. Unfortunately, this approach is not the one which is accepted today. The approach which is accepted today is the next approach, which we call an orthodox approach. We say this particular thing is important, let us read it. The particle was not really there. Our method of measurement, when I made the measurement, then particle took a stand to be present there. It means when I actually made the measurement, I perturbed the system and therefore the particle decided to come there. I mean, decided is under quotes, the particle does not decide. Okay, particle took a stand. Okay, so by my method of measurement, okay, change the condition or altered the conditions so that the particle could be found at that particular thing. So it's my method of measurement which sort of made the particular particle stand to come there. So this is what is called orthodox approach. This is also called Copenhagen interpretation, because as probably you are aware that Niels Bohr had a lot of things to contribute in this particular area, and he was living in Copenhagen. And this particular, the ideas were brought with that particular, you know, set of people which were actually working with Niels Bohr, and this is generally called Copenhagen interpretation. And third approach is agnostic, which is refusing to answer, okay, a question which I cannot answer, why should I bother to answer. So, if you want to look about the details of this particular approaches, this is given in the Griffiths book of introduction to quantum mechanics. As I said, Copenhagen interpretation is the one which is accepted these days, which says that when you perform the experiment, method of performing the experiment has altered the situation and therefore the particle can stand there. Okay, this is something which I will discuss little later in the later part of the course also, okay, about what we call about the collapse of the wave function. Now let us come to the something which is little more mathematical. See, if you look at this particular equation, the nature of the equation is that if psi happens to be some solution of this equation, A into psi will also be a solution, because if you put A times psi, okay, A would cancel out from all the things. Okay. The nature of the equation is that if psi is a solution, A psi will always turn out to be a solution. So, you will always have a variable A which you will not be able to find it out just purely from the solution of this particular A. This particular A is generally found out from what we call as a normalization, because we know that psi star psi represents the probability of finding the particle, and if I look at the probability of finding the particle across the entire universe, that has to be 1. Particle has to be present somewhere, particle must be somewhere. So, if I extend my limit, my condition of finding the particle to right from minus infinity to plus infinity, particle must be somewhere there. Probability of finding some particle somewhere should always be equal to 1. Okay. It means if I integrate psi star psi dx from minus infinity to plus infinity, okay, assuming a Cartesian coordinate system, then this should be equal to 1. Remember, psi star psi dx will give me the probability of finding the particle between x and x plus dx, and I integrate this probability from minus infinity to plus infinity. So, this gives you the probability of finding the particle anywhere from x is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, that must be equal to 1, and that is something which determines A. Okay. So, actually A is found out by what we call as a normalization. This process is called a normalization of the wave function. So, a wave function, just the solution of this will only give you psi, and this A has to be obtained from a different condition which we call as a normalization condition. In fact, I will give you example of all these things, taking a particle in a box as an example, and probably depending upon time, one or two more cases. Now, in general, for a three-dimensional thing, we can write this as psi star psi d tau is equal to 1. And this is entire space. We generally write this as a d tau, taking as volume element. If I am talking of a Cartesian coordinate system, this d tau is just dx dy dz. Then this integral will be triple integral from x is equal to 0 to minus infinity to plus infinity, y is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, etc., etc. If you are using, let us say, spherical polar coordinate, then the d tau can be written as r square dr sin theta d theta d phi, and then corresponding the limits have to be changed from r0 to infinity and things like that. Okay. Also, let us remember there is also an ambiguity, because what you will be able to determine from normalization is only the value of A square, because you know when you are taking this is A, so you will take only the modulus of A square. So, you can determine only with an unknown constant phase factor, unknown phase factor. This I will give an example, I think it will become a little more clear a little later. Now, the fact that you can integrate this, which is called a square integrability, it means you take a square, it means take a complex conjugate and multiply, and then you can integrate it from minus infinity to plus infinity. This actually puts a necessary condition of the wave function. So, wave function must be of a particular type, okay, only then this square integrability is possible. That puts under certain condition the wave function, what we call, has to be well behaved. Okay. It means the it has to possess some conditions. And one of these conditions is that it should be square integrable. Okay. Let me just mention, I am not very sure whether I have mentioned that we are using the word wave function, which we generally use as the solution of the Schrodinger equation. Okay. Wave function is nothing but the wave associated with the particle. So, in quantum mechanics, we call this as a wave function. We have been talking earlier about wave packet. So, what we are talking of wave function is just the wave packet that is associated with the particle. That is the way one has to look at it. I would also like to mention this particular thing, this is also an interesting point, that normalization is strictly not possible for a free wave, as the probability, a particle has equal probability of being found out in the entire space. Okay, in that case, one has to look at the problem in a slightly different fashion. So, these are what we call as a free state problem, about which we will discuss later. There normally we do not normalize the thing, because our interest in is finding out certain different things altogether. So, I am just enumerating here, but all these points I will explain later when I take an example. So, for example, if you take a wave like that e raise power I k x as omega minus omega t, you take complex conjugate of that, that will be A star, assuming that A in general could be complex. Then complex conjugate of this term, change plus I to minus I. So, this becomes minus I, this will cancel, okay. Then it becomes just A star A, and if you integrate from minus infinity to plus infinity, you just get A equal to 0, okay, which does not really make sense. Okay. So this in principle you cannot find out A by integration for a free particle. About that we will discuss later. Okay, what is our interest? We don't really intend many times to normalize them. I mean, if at all you have to normalize it, there are different ways of doing it. I mean, strictly speaking, there is nothing like infinite wave, in fact, we have said. Okay, so we have to look at these particular things in a slightly different fashion. Now, I am just giving a particular example, a particular problem. See, let us assume that the wave function of a particular particle at t is equal to 0 is given by this particular equation. I mean, just a sort of a problem. Okay, let us not bother about whether it is a solution of Schrodinger equation or not. I am just talking of purely from the point of view of giving you the idea of the probabilities. Okay, so let us assume that there is a particle which is represented by a wave function which is given by like this. Okay, let me repeat that. I am not really talking about the Schrodinger equation, just give you idea of the probabilities. Now, a person performs a number of experiments on identical particles which are described by the same wave function at the same time, which is at t is equal to 0, and he finds it to be 100 particles of them are found very, very close to x is equal to 2a. So, I say infinitesimally small vicinity of x is equal to 2a. So, let us say between 2a and 2a plus dx, I find 100 particles there. See, remember this is a continuous variable, so we cannot talk of exactly precise position. So, we say 2a and 2a plus dx, I find 100 of these particles. In how many of these measurements the particle would have been found in the same infinitesimal vicinity of x is equal to a? It means how many number of particles I would have found between x is equal to a and a plus dx, where this dx is the same as in the earlier case. So, I know the wave function, I have just found out that if I make a measurement between 2a and 2a plus dx, I find 100 particles. Okay, question is that if I know the wave function, how many number of particles would have been found between a and a plus dx? It is a simple problem, let us just discuss it earlier. So, as we know, the probability of finding the particle is given between psi x square dx. Okay, so if I have to find out what is the probability of finding the particle between 2a and 2a plus dx, I just put x is equal to 2a. So, if I put x is equal to 2a, so p2a dA will tell me the probability of finding the particle between 2a and 2a plus dx. So, here I put x is equal to a, psi x I have already been given, which is e raise power minus x square by a square, and when I take psi star, so this e raise power minus x becomes twice, it is a real function. So, I take just the square of this thing, say if I take square, it will become e raise power minus 2x square. Okay, so, this is minus 2, for x I have put equal to 2a. Okay, so, this just becomes e square into e raise power, this is 2 square into 2, so this becomes e raise power minus 8, a square cancels out. P of a dx would be given by exactly the same equation, except that for x is equal to 2a, I would have put x is equal to a. So, if I put x is equal to a, I will get minus 2a square, and now a square will cancel. So, I will get a square into e raise power minus 2 dx. So, this would have been the probability of finding the particle at between a and a plus dx. This would have been the probability of finding the particle between 2a and 2a plus x. And I know that this is proportional to 100. So, I have to find out what will be this number. So, this is what I say, p2a upon dx upon pa is equal to dx. So, all whatever is the, you know, sort of coefficient that gets cancelled out. So, I will get e raise power minus 8 divided by e raise power minus 2. Okay, I do not know what is the probability of finding at, how many particles would have been found at pa. So, let us assume that this is a m. So, this e to the power minus 8 has to be proportional to 100. Okay, proportionality constant as I said cancels out. So, I can just calculate p, can calculate m. M will be equal to, I take 100 into 10 power 6, which is approximately 40,000. So, 40,000 particle would have been approximately found between a and a plus dx. Okay. Remember, this is an exponential function. So, this number is exceedingly large. So, this is just to give an idea how I am using wave function to find out the probabilities. Okay, there will be some more questions which I think some of the TAs will take care of. Now, next thing that we define is what we call expected value. Expected value sometimes is a, this name expected is somewhat misleading. See, but why, I mean, in statistics also we use expectation value. This generally means the average value. So, at least as far as this course is concerned, we just take this as a mean value. So, as we have just now seen, in quantum mechanics, there is always a probability associated with the result obtained after measurement. You make a measurement, there is certain probability of obtaining a particular result. Now, this expected value is the average value that one would get after a very large number of measurements were made on identical system with same wave function. So, like example which I have given you, okay, you can, if I have to find out the mean value, expected value of the position, it essentially is mean value of position. So if I have, let's say, 1 million particles, I make the measurement of all of them, all of them are being given by the same wave function, I make the measurement on all of them of the position, I will not find them to be exactly identical, okay, I calculate the average of all of them. If I calculate the average of all of them, then this is what I will say, the expected value of position. So expected value is defined as the average, and let me repeat this thing which I have been telling number of times, is an average value that one would get after a very large number of measurements are made on identical systems, okay, with the same wave function. We must have exactly identical particles with exactly the same wave function and would have made, should have made multiple measurements there, and then only I can calculate what will be the expected or mean value of any particular dynamical variable. At the moment I have talked only about position, but now I will give you, if I have to find out, let's say, mean value of momentum or mean value of any other dynamical quantities, how do I go about it? So as I said, the mean value of x is just this, because psi star psi gives you the probability. There is a reason why this x is put in between psi star and psi. Of course here this is a product, so I could have put this x here also, or I could have put x here also, it would not have made a difference. But there is a reason, because many times when I give a, not many times, but when I give a general definition of the expected value, okay, we have to put everything between psi star and psi. If I take mean of x square, expected value of x square, instead of x, I will put x square. Now, I said, let's try to find out any other dynamical quantity. I may not be just interested in the mean value of position, I may be interested in the mean value of momentum, for example. So, we have talked about the operator, okay, we have said, I mean, we will give a general definition about the operators when we talk about the postulates of quantum mechanics today, okay. We will say that for every dynamical variable, there is an operator associated, okay. Now, this operator, if I know, then the mean value of that particular dynamical quantity, the operator of which is, let us say, g, is given by this particular thing, okay. And this is given by, of course, integral has to be done over the entire space, psi star g psi d tau. Remember, d tau is the volume element, which I have already talked about it earlier. And here it is very, very important to put g here, because g has to operate only on psi, not on psi star, okay. So therefore, the general definition is psi star g psi. If I have to find out the mean value of any dynamical quantity, first I have to look at the operator. This operator must operate on psi xt, multiply by psi star, then you will get the mean value of g, okay. I must mention that these operators are always chosen in such a fashion, or have to be in such a fashion, that this mean value turns out to be real. Though your wave functions are in general complex, even the operators in general can be complex, okay. But on the other hand, we said that mean value has to be real, because this is something which is measurable, okay. Anything that we measure must turn out to be real, okay. So therefore, when we measure these things, this must turn out to be real, and we can show, in fact, when we go to the dynamics, we talk about the postulates, okay, we will talk about this particular aspect, that an operator has to have this particular property, that its mean value must always turn out to be real, all right. The other thing is that when people always ask the question, why we define it in this particular fashion, okay, why is a very difficult question here, because you know, these are, I can always raise my hand and say that these are the postulates of quantum mechanics, okay, there is nothing that I can do about it. But again, I would like to sort of give some justification. These operators are defined so as that they match with the classical mechanics. This particular thing, statement I have made even earlier, that we know that for macroscopic particle, quantum mechanics is not necessary, classical mechanics works. So in the limit of large energies, or for the particles being large, this must enter the classical mechanics, okay. If you look at take an advanced course on quantum mechanics, this is generally shown that this is the way operators have to be defined in order to have consistency with the classical mechanics. Now, for example, now we have already taken defined the operator corresponding to x component of the momentum, which is minus I h cross delta del x. So, if I have to find out the momentum, mean value of the momentum of a particle, and if I know the wave function, then I have to apply minus I h cross. Of course, I h cross is just a pure multiplication and is also a constant. So, minus I h cross I have taken out of this particular integral sign, and del del x has to operate on psi xt. So, this particular expression will give me the mean value of momentum. If I have to find out the mean value of px square, then I have to operate px twice. In fact, I have also given you the operator corresponding to px square when we are talking about the Schrodinger equation yesterday. It will be minus h square del 2 del x square. Again, I have taken minus h square out of the integral sign, this being a constant, okay, this becomes just del 2 psi del x square. Remember again that this operator operates only on psi, psi star is off outside the gambit of this particular operator. So, you must operate this thing and then multiply by psi star, then integrate. Of course, here we are talking of one dimension, so I have put dx, otherwise in general it has to be d tau, and the limits have to be appropriately chosen depending upon what type of coordinate system that you are talking about. Okay, you can always show that the expected value of the momentum will turn out to be real. This I have mentioned even earlier just now, that operators are always chosen such that, you know, any observable quantity has to be real, because mean value of momentum has to be real. Okay, therefore, this must give you a real value. The operators of dynamical variables are always such that their expected value turns out to be real. This is what I have mentioned. Now, there are certain other aspects which I will try to discuss about the difference between, you know, time dependent and time independent Schrodinger equation before I start going into little more interesting aspects about the wave function. So, let us assume that we have solved, we know a particular problem where Vx was actually purely a function of x and there was no time dependence involved. And I solve the Schrodinger equation and obtain phi x. Let us try to find out the mean position of any quantity which is just a function of x. Let us say x, or just x square or x cube or x square plus x or whatever it is, something which is only a function of x. So, let us say there is a function of fx, okay, it could be just simply x, okay, and I want to find out the mean value of this particular thing, okay, using this particular equation, this particular solution of the Schrodinger equation. Now, remember, whenever I am writing this solution, okay, this is not the entire wave function. This wave function has to be multiplied by e raised to the power minus I e t by h cross. So, let us try to find out the expected value of f of x. This is what I will write. Remember, expected values are always written in the angular bracket. This means the mean value or expected value. I apply the definition psi star f of x psi x t, because this is purely a function of f x. This is purely a multiplication operator. I could have written anywhere here. It does not matter. Now, I have already known my phi. This I have found by solution of time independent Schrodinger equation. I realize that psi must be given by phi of x e raised to power minus I e t by h cross. This is the entire wave function. Now, here it has to be psi star. So, I must take complex conjugate of this particular quantity. Let us take in general, I mean, if at all, that psi could be complex. So, I put psi star x here, which is the complex conjugate of psi. Then complex conjugate of e raised to power minus I e t by h cross, minus has to be changed to plus. So, this becomes e raised to power plus I e t by h cross. Okay. Now, everything is multiplication. So, you can see that e raised to power plus I e t by h cross will cancel with e raised to power minus I t by h cross. So, this term, time dependent term, will cancel out. And what you will get is phi star x f of x phi x. Quite interesting, because you find, first of all, that there is no time dependence here. This fx is not time dependent. The mean value of f is not really time dependent. Okay. Second thing is that for calculating this mean averages, I need not have bothered about this time dependent term at all. I could have just used phi star, I could have just used the solution of time independent Schrodinger equation and just written phi star fx phi x, totally ignoring the time dependent part. Now, whenever we have a situation like this, where this particular time dependent part will cancel it out, okay, which will happen with this a particular solution like this, okay, then we call such type of states as stationary state. As I said, this is time independent, these are called stationary state. Whenever the expected value, for example, of fx turns out to be time independent, we call it a stationary state. Also, time dependent part of the wave function is of no consequence in such a case. It should not be now, is of no consequence in such a case. All right. Now, obviously, when I say these are stationary states, you will always think that probably there are certain states which are non-stationary state. Okay. Yes, they are, and this is what I am going to discuss just now. Okay. Let us first try to solve the problem about a particle in a rigid box, which probably all of you are knowing. So, let me try to do a little bit hurriedly, and then after that, I will start discussing about these non-stationary states, because that forms a very, very interesting part of the thing. I think probably that I will do in the afternoon lecture, but let me just quickly go through particle in a rigid box problem, which, as I say, is a very, very simple problem, the simplest problem in quantum mechanics, and let us just try to understand this particular problem. Okay. Then I will use the wave functions of this particular problem and then try to define what is, I mean, I will come back to stationary states and non-stationary state at that particular time. Okay, so let's assume that there is a particle. Okay, remember in Schrodinger equation we always talk in terms of potential energy. Okay, I think some people have asked this question, so let me again tell that V is potential energy, but somehow when we talk in quantum mechanics we are used to calling it potential. I mean, it's true that when we are talking of potential, potential is different from potential energy. I mean, in the entire electrostatics we talk of potential as different as potential energy. Okay, but somehow it so happens that in quantum mechanics we have used to call it, we are used to call it as a potential. So whenever I am saying potential in the sense of Schrodinger equation, we always mean potential energy. Okay, so potential energy of particle is zero between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L and is infinite everywhere else. We have to find out what is the solution of Schrodinger equation, or basically if a particle is contained in this what we call as a rigid box, in a rigid one dimensional box, what will be the energies that this particular particle would possess. That is what we are, let us try to discuss this particular aspect. Particle is between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. Of course, we can show, which I will not show at this particular time, probably we can do it a little later if we have time, that whenever potential energy is infinite, the only solution of Schrodinger equation that is possible is that wave function is 0. It means the probability of finding the particle beyond x is equal to L and before x is equal to 0 would be 0. So wave function will be 0 here, wave function will be equal to 0 here. The wave function will be existing only between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. So particle can be found only within this particular box. It cannot be found anywhere outside this particular box. Of course, remember these cases are somewhat idealistic, but at this moment the idea is to use the Schrodinger equation and try to understand the quantum mechanics rather than going into more realistic problems. Okay. I mean, as we always say, I re-quote my own self, that in physics we always start with the simplest problem, okay, even if it is non-realistic. Okay. Then we try to make it as realistic as possible later on. Okay, so as I said that this wave function phi, I am calling it wave function, but essentially it means phi, okay, is 0 for x less than 0, for x greater than L, as I have just now mentioned, that this is the only solution possible, which I am not showing, which can be shown little later. So the equation, time independent Schrodinger equation, has to be written only between x is equal to 0 and L, and that is what I have written. And in this case, V is equal to 0, so E minus V, the V has become 0, so the equation becomes just like this. And this becomes an equation of this particular type. Okay. Now, E is supposed to be the energy of the particle, which is not supposed to be dependent on x. So, therefore, this is a constant. It is very easy to solve this type of equation. And the general solution, as you know, is a linear combination of a sine term and a cosine term. You could have also used an exponential term. The solution would have been exactly identical. But just let's use a simple sine and cosine term. So the general solution of this particular equation is A sin kx plus B cos kx. This is a second order differential equation. So you will get two unknown constants. One is A, another is B. Okay. Now what you can do, you can substitute this particular equation back here. You will really find that there is a solution. Now this thing is a solution. Here this particular k will turn out to be equal to k square is equal to 2me upon h square. Okay. This equation here you will be obtained when you substitute this equation in the Schrodinger equation here, this particular equation, when you substitute it here, then the relationship k square is equal to 2me upon h square will be obtained. This is rather easy to remember because this tells that E is equal to h square k square by 2m. Okay, using normal standard classical mechanics, h square k square upon 2m means kinetic energy, because potential energy is actually 0 here. So E has to be only kinetic energy. So it's easy to remember it in this particular way. Okay. Here k has to be real, okay, in this particular case, because we are talking of only positive energies, because potential energy is 0 here. So I am talking of the energy states which are only above this particular energy. Now we have to apply boundary conditions, and the first I have not talked yet about the boundary condition. The first boundary condition, which actually pertains to the fact that wave function must be well behaved, is that wave function must always be continuous across the space. Wave function cannot show discontinuities, okay, because eventually wave function is related to something which we can observe, okay, and all realistic things are expected to be continuous. Okay, so if they are sort of continuous, the probability of the finding particle has to move continuously as a function of x, that they cannot change as a function of x. Okay, Now, there are two boundaries here at x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. Okay. As far as the function here is concerned, a combination of sine and cosine functions will always be continuous between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. But I must insist that it should be continuous with the wave function on this end and must be continuous with the wave function on this particular end. So, these are the two points, x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L, where wave function sort of changes. Therefore, I must insist that the wave function is continuous at this edge and at this particular edge. So, this is what I am doing. I remember wave function is 0 here, wave function is 0 here. So, I must have phi of 0 should be equal to 0. Similarly, phi of L should also be 0, because I know that phi for values of x less than 0 is 0 and phi for value of x greater than L is also 0. So, at this particular end also they must be 0. You will appreciate this almost like applying boundary condition for vibration of a string, that the displacement of the string turns out to be 0. Okay. If I put phi 0 to be 0, then I substitute in this particular equation which I have just now obtained, a sin kx plus b cos kx. So, I put a sin 0 plus b cos 0, sin 0 is anyway 0, so this goes away. So, this becomes b is equal to 0 because cos 0 is 1. So, when I say b is equal to 0, okay, if this equation has to be satisfied, then the only way is that b should be equal to 0. And this is also obvious because cosine function is one function which at x is equal to 0 is not going to be 0, and I want the wave function to be 0 at x is equal to 0. This is only possible when there is no cos term present. There is only a sine term, because sine term is the only term for which at x is equal to 0, this particular term would give you 0. So, it means there cannot be a cosine term in the wave function. So, I put b is equal to 0. But now, I also want phi L to be 0. Okay. Now, out of this my wave function, this term has disappeared. All that has happened, remained is a sine kx. So, I put a sine kl and put this equal to 0. Sorry, I am being little faster here, assuming that this particular particle in the box thing has been sort of well studied and well taught by probably all of you. Now, I want a sine kl to be equal to 0. Now, if this is equal to 0, then there are two possibilities, that either a is also equal to 0. If a happens to be 0, b has to be anyway 0, it means the wave function is entirely 0. If wave function is entirely 0, it means the probability of finding the particle in the box will be 0, because wave function is 0. It means the particle does not exist. But I have been told that there is a particle inside a box. Look at the arguments. Okay. We have already been told that there is a particle in the box, and if this particular particle has to exist within the box, its wave function cannot be 0. It means I cannot accept the fact that A is equal to 0. Okay. If A cannot be 0, then sin KL has to be equal to 0, and that is only possible if KL turns out to be equal to n pi. Now, we have already seen the value of K which is given. K is actually related to the energy of the particle. So, I just write this as k as under root 2 me upon h cross from that equation. L must be equal to n pi, which means that in case this condition has to be satisfied, it means in case the wave function has to be well behaved, in case it has to disappear at x is equal to L, then only possibility is that energy takes one of these values, where n is an integer which has to be greater than or equal to 1. About this I will discuss little later, okay, which has to be greater than 1 or greater than or equal to 1. Okay. Only when energy takes one of these values, the wave function will be well behaved and the second boundary condition will be met. Okay. Essentially, it means that energy must possess one of these values where n is an integer. Then only it is possible that, you know, the boundary conditions are met, and see, we have got such a beautiful way, the quantization of energy, which at the time in the earlier cases, you know, we are sort of putting only phenomenologically, you know, there is no logic from which this quantization is coming. This boundary condition has imposed this particular, they have sort of quantized the energy levels, is coming in such a natural fashion by application of the boundary condition. See, I must insist that n has to be greater than or equal to 1, okay, because if n is turns out to be 0, then energy turns out to be 0. If energy turns out to be 0, basically it means k is equal to 0, and k is equal to 0 again means the wave function is 0. And I said I am not going to accept the fact that wave function is 0, because I have been told that the particle exists. So, n is equal to 0 state is not allowed. It's the least value of energy is corresponding to n is equal to 1. Okay. This is what we call as a ground state energy. The ground state energy is the lowest possible energy available to the system. But this comes from a more general principle, that any particular particle which is bound in a limited region of space, okay, its energies must be quantized, and also the lowest energy cannot be 0. This is generally called the zero point energy, the lowest possible energy. Now, there are some certain comments. See, we had two unknowns, A and B. But strictly speaking, we had three conditions, including the normalization conditions. See, I have told that this A cannot be determined by another method other than normalization. Alright, so we had three conditions with only two variables. Now, in case all the three conditions has to be met, this will limit the values of k to certain discrete values. This is the additional equation which is the one which is responsible for quantizing the energy state. The second thing is that the value of n can only be positive and non-zero. This we have discussed, okay, because these are actually solution are stationary waves. So, actually k can always be positive, okay. There is no meaning of negative k. Then I say the lowest energy is non-zero, which we call as a zero point energy. Okay. It means if you put a particle in a box, its lowest energy is always going to be zero. Some people ask a question, suppose I put a small ball in let us say a container, does it mean that it has the lowest, I mean its lowest energy is zero, okay, according to quantum mechanics, yes. Okay. And in this case, because potential energy is zero, so that energy must be kinetic, so does the particle move? Let us just try to calculate. The lowest energy corresponding to n is equal to 1, okay. And let us assume that there is an electron which is kept in a box of 1 angstrom. Then you can calculate these numbers, all are fundamental constants. This will turn out to be 37.6 electron volt. So, if I put an electron in a box of 1 angstrom, the lowest energy that this electron will have is 37.6 electron volt. As you can see, this is quite huge. 1 angstrom is typically the distance between the atoms. Okay? So, I can always imagine a situation where, I mean, it is a sort of realistic situation where the electron could be in a box of 1 angstrom. And in that case, the lowest energy state is 37.6 electron volt, which is a fairly large energy. But on the other hand, if I put a marble, you know, marble which we, the children play, which has a weight of let us say 0.01 kilogram, and I put in a 0.1 meter box, these are typical macroscopic values, then its kinetic energy, lowest energy will turn out to be 5.488 into 10 power minus 64 joules. Means essentially it will take 10 to the power 20 years to move 1 millimeter. So, it means if I really put a marble in this particular box and let us say, okay, I am putting it and therefore it must have a kinetic energy according to quantum mechanics. Yes, it will have a kinetic energy, okay, but it is so small that it will take 1 millimeter movement in 10 to the power 20 years. Obviously, such motions are never possible to observe, okay. So, this particular quantum mechanical effect will never be visible in this macroscopic things, but will be definitely visible when we are talking at microscopic level, when we are talking of particles as tiny as electrons, okay, and when we are talking of boxes which are typically of the order of interatomic spacing. So, therefore, quantum mechanics is necessary when I want to describe the behavior of electron inside a solid, okay. It is not necessary when I want to describe the motion of a marble or a motion of a cricket ball, because there the quantum mechanical effects will essentially be negligible. If I want to normalize, I will just hurriedly go through these transparencies because purely mathematics, and I will anyway upload these things on Moodle. Okay. So, in order to normalize, I must normalize this, and I say for normalization, for calculating the probability, again the time dependent part will be of no consequence because that will be cancelling out. So, I have to just normalize only the phi star. So, if I normalize it, this must be equal to 1. If I evaluate this particular integral, okay, eventually you will get a square l by 2 equal to 1. So, this is what I will be able to determine. So, you can have multiple possibilities of a. So, I can always write as a is equal to e raise power I theta under root 2 by L. This will be the most general solution of this particular equation, which I can determine it. But normally, again conventionally, we always take theta equal to 0 and we write a is equal to under root 2 by L. So, this is what we call as the normalization constant, which is we write, we take the phase angle to be 0. This gives me a is equal to under root 2 by L, which gives me the wave function to be this, which is lying only between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L, and this will be 0 elsewhere. Alright. Now, if I plot this particular thing, this is what I will be getting. This is the wave function and the probability is psi star psi, and this is real. So, it has to be just square. I have roughly plotted. Of course, this is not exactly like this because this has to be squared, but they look identical. So, please excuse me for my bad drawing. So, essentially it says that if the particle is in ground state, okay, which is the lowest energy state, then okay, if you take a very large number of boxes and try to make measurements, you will find maximum number of particles to be found at the center of the box. But if the particle is what we call as a first excited state, okay, energy state just after the ground state, you will hardly find any particle to be in the center of the box. Most of the particles will be found either here or here. Okay. On the other hand, had it been really a classical problem, okay, I mean classically you do not expect these type of things. These are very, very surprising and shocking, okay, as far as wave mechanics is concerned. So I think I will stop here. Our time is over. Today, unfortunately, I do not have time to take any questions from this thing. Okay, I will suggest that please post your questions. Okay, in the afternoon class, if I have some time, then I will try to answer questions from this session as well as from the next session.